Namaskaram. I must admit, I feel extremely honored to be included by Srinidhi and the Krishna Gana Sabha in such a beautifully thought out conference. I was here in 1982. The world has moved on, and it's unbelievable how precise, thoughtful, well presented each of the presentations have been. And to find myself among such a powerhouse of presenters, I mean, so many of them are sitting right here. They're people I've known, but they have made such an impact on their chosen dance forms. Like I say chosen dance forms because of people like Sharmila Biswas, that I'm awed and approach this session with more than a little trepidation. And people here would tell you that I am not usually a nervous person. I'm also nervous for what I may have subjected these young ladies to, because my task, as I see it, is to invite three up-and-coming dancers to an earlier time, when seasoned Bharatanatyam dancers rarely performed a Varnam or Padam or Javali the same way twice. Each time they interpreted a set of lyrics, they refound what these could mean and went deeper and deeper into the significance of the poetry. Moreover, they most often made their discoveries in performance. Of course, there were hardly any lights. There were small rooms. It was a baitak situation, very intimate. And they didn't have to dance to these enormous audiences with lights and worrying about the video and things like that. But still, this improvisatory aspect of Bharatanatyam, for me, has been Bharatanatyam. And I think any of you who saw Bala Saraswati or Shanta Rao or anybody would understand what I'm saying, that that is our ideal, even though we have all, or you have all, taken it so far forward with such extraordinary choreography and such extraordinary complex rhythms and so on. But we want to go back to the time which was there when I studied with my guru Sikil Ramaswamy Pillai. But I learned it from this business of improvisation in a very roundabout way. At 16, I'd been studying with him for about 6 months, having quickly learned an Alaripu and Jadiswaram, because you had to learn sets when you went, no? We were working on a Shabdam, and I'd been doing it for about 2 months, 3 months or something. So I was getting a little bored. So one day when Tata was late, and as K.J. Govindarajan, yes, the flutist Raghuraman's father, was then Natan Vinar to my guru. He was singing the Shabdam and beating also on the Talam. And I decided to try something different. Instead of the usual Vannaladine playing sticks and things like that, as Sakhis do. And actually, quite naively, all I did was Vannaladine. And as that happened, I closed my eyes, in came Tata. What? Rajika. I froze like this. And he came up to me, lifted my elbow, lifted my thing. Nallarka. Okay, today Varnam. I've just started getting excited about the Shabdam, and he's going on to the Kamas Varnam. Well, it took me some time. And I only understood that he had been waiting for me to play with the lyrics, to spontaneously start improvising before he moved on. So you didn't learn by words. And even after that, with jatis, I found myself, I would listen to the jati. And then depending on it, and I would choose the adavu that went with it. Even today I do that, because you listen. Because the choreography used to be very simple, the jatis were very simple, not like the stuff that you do today, which does, I have to admit, need a lot of practice. But Srinidhi had, as she said, thought it would be interesting to lead some younger performers to improvise their renditions of padams, to be spontaneous in their expression of sringaram. My challenge was a way to figure this out, because, of course, proper improvisation can only be done with something you know very well and have already explored. So what I did was give the dancers three poems, following Srinidhi's advice that they should be in Tamil so that the audience could understand it, and also that the dancers themselves could respond to the words and hear them again. So unfortunately, I don't really know these padams backwards because most of the repertoire we used to do was in Telugu or in Kannada or whatever in when we were first studying. So I told them about 2 weeks ago which pada I wanted them to do. Then just an hour before this session, I gave them a set of instructions on how I wanted them to interpret the lyrics. So some suggestions. For example, I said to several repetitions of the Pallavi, they should explore, for example, different kinds of Naikas who could express those words. A Mugdha, Praudha, mature woman, seasoned in love, a wife or a courtesan, an Uttama or someone who took liberties with her lord, behaving slightly less Uttama. I wanted in particular for them to go against their personalities. I wanted this to be an acting exercise. It's not about me, it was because one cannot get rid of oneself, but to transform and find this other person that is saying, I can't believe that he's coming today, or I can't believe he's coming today. You know, I mean, just play with it. I asked them to figure out where the Nayaka was and let us know through her being there rather than saying, okay, so we're here and the procession is coming. You just sort of want to know that she's sitting there and that what is she's really trying to do is you feel that she's trying to watch something. And of course, we know what that is from the lyrics. Also, it was very important for them to see the Nayak. Even if you're talking to a Sakhi or talking directly to him or to a Murti that you expect to see, what is in your mind, the person who is driving you crazy is a person. And I want to know, is he listening to you like this? What is his attitude? You know, I want to feel through your eyes that there is a response. It's a conversation even though he is not speaking. And lastly, to remember that we should in the end relish the depth of her love for the Nayak, because the idea was to hopefully elicit Sringara Rasa in us. So bearing this in mind, that it's an experiment, which should be fun for the dancer and for you. Let's start with the first padam, Teruval Varano, sung by Srimati Radha Badri, accompanied, as you know, by Nellai Kannan on Mridangam and Kalai Arasan on violin, and interpreted by Harini Jeevita. For those who may not speak Tamil or know this well-known song, suffice it to say its protagonist is a young woman who, hearing the sounds of the Lord's procession setting out from the temple, wonders, if he passed by my street, even perhaps he look at me? Only in the second line do you discover who he is. So they're going to repeat the Pallavi many times as they discover for today this particular poem. Thank you. Ragam Kamas Thala Rupakam.
ನಟನ ರಾಜನ್ ಉರುವಿನಿಯೋಡ ತೆರೆ ಪುರತೆಯುಂ ಉಡನೆ ಸೈದ ನಟನ ರಾಜನ್ ಉರುವಿನಿಯೋಡ ತೆರೆ ಪುರತೆಯುಂ ಉಡನೆ ಸೈದ ನಟನ ರಾಜನ್
ಸಗಂ ಸು
போது போகுதில்லையே, எனக்கு ஒரு தூது செல்வதில்லையே.
I'm not nervous anymore. I'm just wondering how the young generation is taught like this. Congratulations to the gurus. Congratulations to all the senior artists whom they go and watch. Wow. Wow. Look at where Bharatanatyam is, and people ask, is it relevant? Please, Without it, what do we have? Wonderful. Thank you so much, Harini. And, of course, you do need a wonderful musical accompaniment, a singer. Because you can't do it on your own. And that is why it is Sangeet. And that is why Bala. I remember first seeing her, there was a sort of a mic at IFAX in Delhi, dangling. Because sometimes it was, you know, she didn't have Gauri Amani, but like that to sing for her. So sometimes she'd get irritated and she would start to sing herself when she wanted to, didn't feel that she was getting the rasa. Anyway, amazing. The next dancer is Nitya Pillai. As you heard, she's the granddaughter of Guru Swami Malai K. Rajaratnam Pillai and from an old, you know, we really do miss the gurus. I am a little not sure of the numbers of people who call themselves gurus who are also performing themselves. The big thing about the old gurus were they did not perform. They held the tradition and they watched and they, it's like directing your own play. I'm not saying you can't do it, but you have to know what you are doing to be able to do so. And her padam is Aasai Mukham in Jaunpuri, as we know. And we know the story about it, what it could possibly mean. And I told Nitya, don't worry about it, whether it's his mother or who he's talking to. Listen to the words again. Because in it, the Naika wonders at the fact that though she's deeply in love with her beloved, she can't seem to remember his physical features, the vision of his face. She's perplexed and disturbed. How can I be truly so deeply in love and not be able to picture him?
Nesam marakkavillai ஆசை முகம் மறந்து போ.
What a thought, actually, even though they say this was written to his mother, but it is so profound. When she started to describe the accoutrements of Krishna, I suddenly realized, what does he look like? I mean, he's not all those paintings that I've seen. That's not, if I had seen him, what does the face of God look like? It's a very profound understanding of this phenomenon in this poem. I was also thinking it would be wonderful if you could do a kacheri where you had three or four dancers so that you could actually enjoy a whole evening of extraordinary work. And if you actually understood it, the new is important, but don't forget the tried and true. So the third and last dancer is Sri Vidya Sailesh, disciple of the lovely dancer Shobhana, and for whom she often does Natuvangam in concert. And her padam is Netrandi Neratile in Husseini. Beautiful ragam. The Husseini Swarajati is one of my favorites, in which the Nayika asks the lover, who was it that I saw you with last evening at dusk, which suggests that it's dark. And she's not quite sure. She's giving him an out. But who did I see you with? And then goes on to describe what she saw.
Yeah.
நெருங்கி உம்மை காட்டி அழைத்த நேரத்திலே நீராடும்
I have an answer to my own question about gurus. If you can sit and watch an extraordinary performer and study with her, and I'm saying her because I'm contrasting it to the male guru, actually, for today's day, there is so much that can be learned. I saw Dakshina dance yesterday, Dakshina Vaidyanathan, and she did Todi Ragam, she did Rupam Ujuchi, and it was extraordinary, and Rama said, she choreographed it herself, you know. And I realized that, yes, it is in the style of her mother, but she's taking it somewhere else. And there's something about her mother's discovery through performing that adds layers and layers and layers to what you can learn. So yes, Guru Shobhana, Guru Rama, them calling you that, I think today is apt, if I may say so. And then, of course, the most important element of all of this is, and I understand why Srinidhi said, choose Tamil poems. And so I said, well, they know the Telugu. She says, yes, but for the audience. And I thought, what a good point. If you understand, then you can really appreciate the nuances. And if you know the songs backwards, then perhaps you see something new in it. Can I call the dancers on stage? I was asked to comment on them, but actually I'd like to ask them to just make a one-minute comment. You're not going away, because you guys are absolutely amazing for it. We need to end. I know we started late, but you people were really succinct and quite honestly awesome. I was supposed to ask you make comments. You know, I thought this was good and that was... of course not. That's ridiculous. But what I would love is to have each of you just a couple of sentences on how it felt to do this. Each of you come up to the mic so you can speak.
Namaskaram. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Srinidhi Chidambaram and Rajika Puri ma'am for giving me this unique opportunity today. I think exploring, experimenting, and realizing that a song lends its way to inexhaustible interpretations is something new for me. And I think it's time that I start listening to and paying keen attention to the unheard voices of all the songs. Thank you.
Beautifully, beautifully put. Nitya.
Namaskaram to all. When I started talking to Rajika ma'am about this session, she gave me Aasai Mugam. And if any of you have, any of us who follow the dance world know that my grandfather's rendition of Aasai Mugam is one of those unforgettable ones. And I've heard it all my life, and we've been doing it in a certain way all our life, and my wish this time was to do it differently, in a slower pace, and to add in elements. For me, it is a poem of grief. That's what I feel. More than Shringaram, grief is what I usually feel. But this time I wanted to take it to a little playful scenarios of what she remembers with him, and to add some other flavors to the padam that I've done differently. So this has been very enlightening for me, that I can do different things. When you come from a Natunar parampara, you are taught a certain thing and you do it. You don't ask questions. But in recent times, with what I'm seeing around, I've learned to ask questions too. And it's helping me. Thank you.
Well said. I hadn't known that about your grandfather. Sri Vidya Sailesh.
Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Good evening. Sorry, good afternoon. So, this Husseini Padam was new to me. I haven't been taught the piece by my guru. So, you know, it is a Vipralabdha Nayaka, but, you know, adding a different color to her, her character, her shade, it was a completely new experiment for me. I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you all for being here. I think we're all waiting for lunch. So, can we thank the extraordinary musicians that Srinidhi gets? Powerhouse will get powerhouse. And make powerhouses of the dancers.
Thank you so much, Radhika ji, and the musical team and the young dancers. I'd like to thank you.
I mean, what did you do this all the time? I'm intrigued to know what's inside. Thank
And now it's time to really bid farewell and say goodbye. I feel sad that this vibrant gathering where we all met with such enthusiasm for the last 5 days is about to wind to a close. I really have no words to say how much I enjoyed putting this conference together. I am overwhelmed by the full houses that we drew every day, and I was really touched by the warmth, affection, goodwill, that all seemed to engulf me like a cocoon, making me feel energized and cherished by all of you. I am humbled by the indulgent affection shown to me by every member of the dance fraternity, be it legendary senior artists, my own generation of artists, or the younger lot, much as they would indulge a member of their own family. In fact, I noticed a distinct sense of easy camaraderie, friendliness, and an informal air pervading the entire 5 days, and that gave me a lot of confidence. And I am delighted to see all the smiles, the joy, the artists and the audiences reflected in their offstage interactions. I was anxious yet proud that venerated commentators were here, like Leela Venkatramanji, Sunil Bhai, Devika ji, Rao Tata, Janaki, so many others. And they were there each day to critically observe and evaluate the proceedings, and I'm so grateful to them for being here. To me, the conference has again reaffirmed that dance is embedded deep into my heart and soul and will be so forever. I hope you all enjoyed Sringaram as much as I did in putting it together. I hope many new ideas and thoughts would have sprung up. Seeds of innovation would have been sown on creative minds, and I hope that we will go back enthused with multiple unforgettable memories of what we have seen and heard. And at this point, I also would like to acknowledge the wonderful support that Kalakshetra as an institution has provided me this year, as they did last year. And in token of my eternal appreciation to them for having so many students come every day, I'd like to invite one of you from Kalakshetra to also come and take a small memento from me. Finally, I look upon each one of you as a friend and co-traveler in our journey with dance, and I wish to end by saying this. Rivers run long, seeming to end at one point, yet in truth they just go on, for currents are ceaseless. They find their own paths. They symbolize continuity. Rivers run long. Dance too runs along and runs forever in all of us. May it give us all eternal peace and joy. Thank you. Namaste.